Okay, good evening, everyone. Welcome to our council meeting for the 21st of October. We'll call the meeting to order. And first thing we need to do, of course, is adopt the agenda. Recommendation that the agenda for the October 21st, 2024 regular meeting of council be accepted and passed. Can I get a mover and a seconder? Councillor Burke, Councillor McCabe, thank you. Any questions or comments? All those in favor? It's carried. Thank you. Go through the disclosure of pecuniary interest process. Because I missed the last meeting and had a pecuniary interest in the closed session on the September 23rd meeting, just wanted to bring that forward as I couldn't declare it in my absence last meeting. Any other declarations of pecuniary interest? Councillor Burke.
Yes. So under planning on the regular council agenda, I have 1C, 1D, and 1E. I have an indirect pecuniary interest as my employer has prepared appendices for those reports.
Thank you. Any other, Councillor McCabe?
I have none.
Councillor Hearn?
No.
Councillor Rankin?
I have none.
Okay, thank you. We'll move to our closed meeting session. We have a recommendation here that the Council of the Corporation of the Township of Wellington North go into a meeting at 6:31 p.m. It's closed to the public under subsection 239, number 2 of the Municipal Act 2001, specifically to deal with personal matters about an identifiable individual, including municipal or local board employees, and labor relations or employee negotiations. And we'll deal with a couple of reports. HR 2024-003, proposed QP agreement, July 1st, 2024 to June 30th, 2026. And HR 2024-004, non-union remuneration. And we'll deal with review of the closed session minutes from October 7th, 2024. Can I get a mover and a seconder for that, please? Councillor Hearn, Councillor McCabe, thank you. All those in favor? That's carried. But we're closed.
Let's lock the webinar and pause the recording. There's a recording button. Recording. Pause.
So I have a recommendation here that the Council of the Corporation of the Township of Wellington North rise from a closed meeting session at 6:57 p.m. Moved by Councillor Hearn, seconded by Councillor Rankin. All those in favor? It's carried. Coming out of the closed, we have a recommendation that the Council of the Corporation of the Township of Wellington North receive report HR 2024-003, proposed QP agreement July 1st, 2024 to June 30th, 2026, I think that should be, and that council approved the confidential direction to staff. I get a mover and a seconder. Councillor Burke and Councillor McCabe, thank you. All those in favor? That's carried. And we have the recommendation that the Council of the Corporation of the Township of Wellington North receive report HR 2024-004, non-union remuneration, and that council approved the confidential direction to staff. Moved by Councillor Hearn, seconded by Councillor McCabe, all those in favor? That's carried. Thank you. And finally, we have recommendation that the Council of the Corporation of the Township of Wellington North approve the closed meeting minutes of the October 7th, 2024 council meeting. Could I get a mover and a seconder? Councillor Burke and Councillor McCabe, thank you. All those in favor? That's carried. Thank you. Welcome, everybody. So we're just to get started with our open sessions. Are you ready to? Okay, we'll start with O Canada. So if you could rise, if you're able, that would be great.
Yeah.
Thanks. We have a couple of awards, declaration, recognitions this evening. We have on our agenda, we have Arthur Fall Fair Ambassador presentation. Were we expecting them to be in attendance?
Yes, we were.
Okay, so maybe we'll just set that one aside for the moment. And we'll move on to our second one, which is the Arthur Lyons Club 85th Anniversary Proclamation. So one. We have here proclamation that reads as follows. Whereas the Arthur Lyons Club is a member of the Lyons Club Clubs International with 1.4 million members and 50,000 clubs in more than 200 countries and geographical areas. And whereas the motto of Lyons Club International is "We Serve," and the Arthur Lyons Club is a valuable service club in the community. And whereas the Arthur Lyons Club was established on November 14th, 1939, and is celebrating 60 years of service. That doesn't seem to add up. 85. I think we're going to have to redo this. 85 years of service is comprised of volunteers who dedicate their time to the betterment of our communities and aiding those in need. And whereas the Arthur Lyons Club participate in a number of annual community events and hosts the annual Rubber Duck Race, and whereas the Arthur Lyons Club has supported various local charitable causes, including the Brent Barnes Memorial Skate Park, now therefore I, Andrew Lennox, Mayor of the Township of Wellington North, do hereby proclaim the month of November 2024 as Arthur Lyons Club Month in Wellington North. Proclaimed and adopted this 21st day of October 2024. So thanks very much. See, we have a number, quite a number of members of the Lions Club. We will get the typo cleaned up here, but I would love be happy to present this to your membership and like to want to do a wish to do a photo. This would be a great time for that. Oh, yeah.
I don't need to be saying right now. 50 years, so wow. Congratulations.
Just didn't look right. But tidied up already. It's over on your desk. Yeah. Okay, well, we'll just set this other one aside for now, and hopefully our fair ambassador can get here and we can deal with that. But I see Councillor O'Neill is here, so we'll move on to our county council update. Welcome, Steve.
Safer now that the lines are black.
Okay. It's green now. Yep. Just want to bring a couple things to council's attention. Nothing controversial or anything like that. Starting January 1st, there's going to be a minimum $10 fee to drop off waste or recycling at landfill or transfer stations. Site attendants will be weighing loads brought in to determine the fee that will be charged. Any loads lighter than 74 kilograms, 160 pounds, would be charged the minimum fee. Over 74 kilograms is charged at $135 per ton. So 200 kilograms, about 440 pounds, would be $27. If you're going to bring bag garbage to the sites and not use curbside pickup, don't use the yellow bags because you'll be paying twice because they're not going to be free any longer. Might as well use a black bag. You will still be able to drop off leaf and yard waste, tires, household hazardous waste, and electronics for free. Those are items that are being get handled through different provincial programs. July 1st, 2025, we've talked about this before, the producers of recycled material are going to be responsible for the pickup in Wellington County. So when we accept, if we accept recyclable waste at Riverston or a transfer station, we'll have to pay to truck it to a recycling depot. The producers will not pick up at our sites. The residents won't see a change at the time. It'll still be curbside collection. Many municipalities throughout Ontario have already gone through this transition. Wellington County, we're in the last group of the municipalities that are going to go through the process. Also, when the producers take over recycling, businesses will not be serviced. The county is going to contract out and pay for our downtown businesses to continue receiving recycling pickup. And we're also looking into the pricing for picking up recycling for businesses who are not on our main downtown cores. For instance, a dentist office that's a block or two off the main street. We're going to see if we can go to them as well, but it's going to all come down to cost. Again, with the new process, the producers do not have to pick up at businesses. Automated speed enforcement is going to be piloted throughout the county shortly. Signs announcing the placement of cameras must be up for 90 days before going live. And in Wellington North, it will be set up on County Road 6 in front of the Wellington Heights Secondary School. Automated speed enforcement can only be set up in community safety and school zones. So throughout the county, each of the seven municipalities will have one camera. And they'll be pretty well all in school zones. Center Wellington, for instance, is going from the old high school at Highway 6 east past J.D. Hogarth. And that's all I have for you this evening. I'll answer any questions. There might be some for this stuff.
Thank you. And through you, Mayor. Thanks, Councillor O'Neill. Just going back with the first part of your report, how does that make any sense?
Like, what's that?
Like the county is still going to have to pay for pickup, even though it's producers that are going to be picking up.
Just for the businesses, we're going to pay for the businesses.
But how will this affect like our myself?
Won't affect you at all at your place. The producers are going to go by your place and pick up recycling, same as always. It's a small like a small business anywhere on our main streets, whether it's a restaurant or a store that puts out recycling, they do not have to pick up the recycling from businesses.
Then we're going to get that. Like, the county is going to have to pay for
correct. That. That's what we have decided. So when we currently we pay about $4 million a year for blue box pickup. The producers reimburse us approximately $2 million. So we're going to save $2 million. So we're going to turn around and spend some of it going back and picking up the businesses, because we realize that's going to be a hardship for a lot of small businesses. The city of Guelph, I don't believe, picks up garbage or recycling for their small businesses anymore. So if you had a small store, you either get a dumpster or you go to the transfer station in Guelph and you pay at that point to take it. Yeah, it started probably 12, 15 years ago, the first talk of it, likely. It's been quite a while.
Okay, thank you.
Okay.
Any other questions? Steve, at this point? Go ahead.
Thank you. I was wondering, is it possible to get a copy of the report that you just read for the garbages so that we can have a look at it and digest it?
Yep, can do that. There's okay.
Thank you.
Questions?
Just not a question, just a comment. When I was at the landfill at the Riverstown dump on the weekend, they did hand a card, a very nice explanation of why the things were going to add all of that information on.
Maybe that's, we can circulate, probably be the best thing for us to circulate at this point so that everybody has the same piece of information. So that's it.
Just for a little context, I guess, at the Riverston landfill in 2023, there was an average of 418 customers to that site a week. Elora's just over 1,600. The Elora transfer station is literally in the village of Elora. It's going to be surrounded soon, and that they get a lot more traffic there.
So this would push more business to the curbside collection, which is already being paid for. At least that's the expectation. Anything further? Thanks very much. Thanks for me.
The Lions are gone. I'll be safe to go leave.
Okay. So I go back to our awards section. Now Haley Story is welcome.
Thank you for having us. I'd like to apologize for being late.
Oh, that's been all right. Just juggling things around. Just delighted to have the opportunity to congratulate you.
Thank you very much.
And welcome you to being an ambassador for our community, along with the rest of us. So with that, I have a little presentation here.
Get out.
Well, again, I can wear or trade, whatever.
Thank you ever so much. Thank you so much.
For
the rest of the councilors,
Another
the lion said they fell there for us.
But if you need more pins, just let us know.
Sounds good.
That's a good idea. Okay,
thanks. I think I have three pins.
No, Penny.
Are you enjoying it so far?
It's good. It's good. Oh, yeah. Yeah. A couple of minutes. It's good. You can also do this.
That's right.
Thanks again.
Have a good night. Worry, I'm not sad. Wyatt.
Well, you're, but I haven't been near Wyatt, so.
Adoption of the minutes of the Council and Public Meeting from October 7th. With a recommendation that the minutes of the regular meeting of Council and the public meeting held on October 7th, 2024 be adopted as circulated. There are moving second for that. Pass on Herb, pass on Kate. Thank you. Any questions or comments on those minutes? All in favor? Great. Thank you. That is perfect. I don't believe we have any business arising from previous meetings of council, so it's so good. It's just the spring fell out of it. We'll move on to items for consideration. We have, I think it's pulled out previously, include 1A, 1C, 1B, 1E, 2A, and 4A. And this recommendation reads as follows. That all items listed under items for consideration on the October 21st, 2024 Council agenda, with the exception of those items identified for separate discussion, be approved, and the recommendations therein be approved. I'm going to move to second of that, Councilor Drinkin and Councilor Hearn. Thank you. All in favor? Okay. Yeah. Back to 1A.
Mm-hmm. And we're having trouble hearing.
Okay, sorry. Move the microphone here. Hopefully that solves the problem. Okay, we're on to 1A. Compared to consent applications B74, 75, and 76-14. On the recommendation here, the Council of Corporation of the Township of Wellington North received report DEV 2024-27, consent applications B74, 75, 76-24 for Wilson Developments. And the Council support consent applications B74, 75, and 76-24 as presented with the following conditions. That the owners satisfy all the requirements of the local municipality, financial and otherwise, including but not limited to taxes paid in full. A fee of $250 for township clearance letter conditions, or whatever fee is applicable at the time of clearance under the municipal fees and charges bylaw, which the Township of Wellington North may deem it to be necessary at the time of issuance of the certificate of consent for the proper and orderly development of the subject lands, and that the owner satisfy the requirements of the Township of Wellington North in reference to parkland dedication consistent with bylaw 11-22. And further, the council authorizes the development clerk to file with the secretary treasurer of the Planning and Land Division Committee, County of Wellington, a letter of clearance of these conditions on completion of same. They're going to move her in a second, please. Councilor McCabe, Councilor Rankin, thank you. Questions or comments? Councilor Rankin.
Yes, I was just wondering, I have several actually. The easement that goes down the side of the first, or pardon me, yeah, the first and the fourth, they are going down. There's only wide enough for public access rather than vehicle access. And they are cutting across the middle of the backyard of number four and number one. Is that correct?
Who wants to tackle that one?
Curtis is on the line.
Curtis?
Good evening, Mayor Lennox, members of council. So to answer Councilor Rankin's question, so the easement is a requirement of the township when we have townhouses or other multiple dwellings. There's a requirement to make sure that there's rear yard access. that basically would allow someone to bring a wheelbarrow or their lawnmower to those middle units without having to go through the house. So we want to avoid situations where someone would have to carry their lawnmower up and downstairs or, you know, through their living room to get to the backyard. So that is the purpose of the easement. So in terms of where it is located, I noticed that as well, that it's not, you know, sort of at the middle or the front portion. Now, these are the one thing I did note. The lot is very, very deep. And what they're proposing here, it's approximately at least 30 feet back where the easement would be. So that would be probably the normal length of a regular sized residential lot. So that I that's my understanding that they've placed it sort of back at sort of a reasonable point. I mean, they could bring it back to the very back, but they've chosen to put in that location.
You have further questions?
Yes.
Go ahead.
Through you, Mayor Lennox, then. I was just wondering, for clarification, they have a lane marked at the bottom of the diagram. Is that lane accessible to any of those four properties?
Curtis, are you able to help with that?
Sure. Yeah, my understanding is it isn't directly accessible to them. That was one thing the developer did ask. And I believe it was checked with roads and engineering at the township, and that it wasn't it doesn't exist as a lane or a walkway right now. And there's also a couple trees located in sort of directly in the middle of it. And I see Tammy may have a better answer than me. So,
yeah, I noticed there's no access that I could see onto Newfoundland Street to the backs of those properties. And what is the it's like a circle with wide scalloped edges. There are two of them.
Through you, Mr. Mayor. So I believe those, if you're referring to those, would be maybe the trees. Those would be the canopy of the trees.
Okay, and the one that has smaller wiggly lines, and it's right by the back porch of number 2 and 3.
I believe that's was a bush.
Okay, thank you.
Yep.
So I'm sorry, but I feel that having easements like this is not conducive to good neighbor policies, especially down the road in the future. You could get people in there that are going to object to having people crossing their yard when they're out enjoying their own backyard. And I'm just wondering, is there anywhere in the bylaw that states, like, why now are they asking for a severance when they've already started building? Why wasn't the severance requested before the building started?
Through you, Mayor Lennox, Councilor Rankin. So right now, the zoning bylaw would permit a four-unit dwelling on the property, so they don't have to sever it. It could stay as one property with four units and in a rental situation. So my understanding is that they're proposing to sever it so that they then could sell each individual unit separately.
Okay, my next question then would be, is there anywhere in the bylaw that describes a townhouse on a severed lot like that? Because if you sever those the other three lots off, you are going to have one living unit on one piece of land, and there is no medium distance setback.
Through the chair. So I'm not, maybe I'm not exactly sure of your question, Councillor Rankin. Like, just to try and help to answer, we do permit, so these would be considered street townhouses, as they have access directly onto Wellington Street East, and they are permitted as either on one lot in the bylaw as a four unit townhouse, and that is the maximum that you could have is four units in a row, one property, and then they are also permitted then to be individually divided up with one unit on one lot as proposed. So I don't know if that answered your question directly.
Yes and no. Okay. I can understand four townhouses on one piece of property. That's fine, though I'm not happy with the easements. But if you divide it up, you are allowing one unit, which is an individual living unit, to be on a piece of property with no set minimal distance setback. And yet if somebody had gone on to try and build on one of those, they wouldn't be allowed to do that because they wouldn't be allowed to go right to the property line. So I'm just wondering why it's allowed for a townhouse to separate like that with no distance to the property line when you can't do it if you're building fresh.
So through the mayor, again, Councillor Rankin, so by definition in the bylaw, a townhouse would be permitted to have a zero setback, so they are allowed to touch on the lot line, similar to a semi-detached. So they are allowed in that instance as that unit to have a zero setback on their internal lot lines, and then the end units do require the 1.2 meter setback on the end units.
Okay, I see. I'm not in favor of it, but I see. Yeah.
Any other questions with regard to this? Okay, all those in favor then? Opposed? It's carried. On to 1C. This is in regard to the consent application B87-24 Community Living, Guelph, Wellington. I'll read the recommendation. It reads that the Council of the Corporation of the Township of Wellington North receive report DEV 2024-29, consent application B87-24 Community Living, Guelph, Wellington easement, and the Council support consent application B87-24 as presented. And further, that council authorizes the development clerk to file with the secretary treasurer of the Planning and Land Division Committee at the County of Wellington a letter of clearance of these conditions on completion of the same. Can I get a mover and a seconder, please? Councillor McCabe, Councillor Hearn, thank you. Questions or comments? Councillor Rankin?
Through you, Mayor Lennox. Again, it's just a matter of easements. I really don't like them. I'm sorry. I just feel that they can create problems later on down with neighboring, even though this is a business, that some of the, I guess, guidelines for the use of easements can be abused.
Okay. Any other questions or comments? I agree with you, Councilor Rankin, that easements are not the ideal solution. Unfortunately, when you have tight properties, it's one of the only ways we have to accommodate to make sure properties continue to have access. Any other questions, comments? All those in favor? Opposed? That's carried. Move on to 1D now. It's a fairly lengthy recommendation there. I'm going to hope that council's not going to ask me to read it all out in its entirety. Can I get a mover and a seconder for that, please? Councilor McCabe, Councilor Rankin, thank you. Any questions or comments on that? This is in regard to B19-24 for Karen Kammermeyer. Councilor Rankin, go ahead.
Through you, Mayor Lennox, I was just wondering if a portion of that barn is demolished because it will be on the agricultural portion of the land, will the remainder of the barn be going right to the property line, or will there be a setback for that?
So I want to make sure I understand the question. So the portion of the building that exists today is to be demolished. And your question is that upon demolition, will there be a setback from the remaining building to the property line? Is that right? Curtis, are you able to help us with that?
Yes, Mayor Lennox. I was just looking for the revised sketch. So this, yes, my understanding is there is a proposed setback, so that when they do remove half the building, then there would also then be a minimum setback that would have to be met for an accessory building. So effectively, it would turn out turned from a drive shed into an accessory building. So I believe that's one of the conditions that the building department has requested, is that you know, there be the proper permits and review as of that building as a condition. So they would have to do changes to the structure of the building likely, and to make sure it meets the setbacks as well.
Thank you. One more, please.
Sure, go ahead.
I was just wondering, the motion that Councillor Hearn made at the other council meeting regarding the size of lots from that are being severed in these instances, will it have any bearing on this one, or is this incident going to be going through before that motion may be addressed?
Go ahead. Sure, Mayor Langs, I can tackle that to Councillor Rankin. So we did receive the motion from the township, and that'll be on the next agenda for Land Division Committee in November. So that would be at the same meeting. So your motion will resolution and to the committee will be there for their consideration when this is heard by them as well.
Any other questions or comments? Councillor Hearn?
Yeah, I just wanted to thank planning staff for working with this one to decrease it a lot. I do prefer the proposal that's brought forward here by the planning to square it off. It actually hope that maybe it could even come in a little bit further on the west line there next to, I can't read, the Weeping Bed. I don't know whether it can get closer to that or not. Maybe that's just a comment. My second one is more of a question. It's around the policy and 10.3.4 of the county official plan. Just trying to verify, like this is supposed to be, it says that it's surplus to a farm operation as a result of a farm consolidation. And the intent is for farmers so that they can decrease the cost of acquiring land and not be a landlord to the house. The retained parcel, so the farm, is currently for sale on MLS. So is there a way for us to verify that this is actually a farm consolidation? Because I don't think that this lot severance policy in our official plan is intended to be a speculative policy where people are out to make money. And I'm not sure whether that's the case, but I'd just like to verify that this is actually a farm consolidation as is written in our official plan. Because I think that there's an expectation when we provide consent here at the township that those other things have been met.
Okay. Curtis, can you provide any context around that?
Yes, sure, Mayor Lennox. So the county, when a farm surplus farm dwelling application is submitted, we do have a farm consolidation sheet that we ask that the applicant fill out, that they indicate that they have other land holdings. And in a lot of cases, this would be from a potential purchaser because it can't yet be transferred till it's created. So that is something that then the Land Division Committee would have to consider is, you know, does the purchaser have or if it's a farmer who has multiple farm dwellings, that they do have other land holdings. Ultimately, it's not something 110% that we can confirm because we can't, once it's created, we can't condition who purchases it. But it is an expectation, and we ask the applicant to confirm that.
Okay. Thank you. Any other questions or comments? I personally am not in favor of this configuration. To me, this flies in the face of the policy in terms of minimizing lot size and creating a very irregular shaped parcel. I think we need to make sure that the conditions that we're including in this need to go forward to Land Division, but I am not in support of endorsing this application, even as it's revised. So
I'm not sure from a process perspective. I mean, I guess I would look to other members of council whether there's any consensus around that, or whether we council wishes to endorse it as presented. But if there isn't an endorsement for it as presented, then I'm not sure what the process would be to make sure we carry these conditions forward. Councilor Hearn?
Yeah, I tend to agree with you. The way the policy is written, it's supposed to render the retained farmland. It's not supposed to leave it inefficient to farm. And that is really not good configuration there. Like I think it honestly, I would rather see the entire back if we're going to entertain it at all. Not everything is a good candidate for a surplus farm dwelling severance. And I don't think that this is really the intent of the policy as it's written. I mean, I'm not very supportive of it the way that it is.
So I think from the process, what's happened in the past is council says that they're not in support of the proposal in front of them, but then you want to say that if the land division committee, you know, approves it, we need to have these conditions. Otherwise, if you just say no and don't impose conditions, then you don't get any.
And I don't want to stop either. Anyone else want to weigh in on this one? Curtis, go ahead.
Yeah, so this, thank you, Mayor Lennox. This application, so it was to the committee once and it was deferred. So this is a recirculation back to the township. So if council wishes to see a different configuration, you could indicate that in your comments if there's a preferred, it's cut off at a certain point, or we could even have a modify the sketch yet again, and we could bring that back to the land division committee. But I think, as Karen mentioned, it'd be important to still provide conditions, but I think you can certainly suggest a preference for size or shape, and that would likely be helpful for the committee as well to understand the township's council's desire.
Okay. Thank you. And I don't think council was supportive of the configuration in the previous iteration of the application. Councilor Rankin, any thoughts?
I'm not in support of it as it is now.
Councilor McGee?
I'm good with supporting it. I'm good with not supporting it either, and going back with conditions set so that we can set in place proper conditions.
Okay.
That makes sense.
Yeah, my personal preference would be to extend it out to that shed. It doesn't make any sense at all to me. Get the acreage down and square it up.
I could almost follow that line towards the east. I can cut that little back section off.
Yeah. Would be my preference.
Yeah.
Councilor Hearn?
Yeah, I agree. I think that back section should be completely cut off. And even the size of the shed that's proposed to remain, that we're talking about removing now, it's really large for a residential parcel. In essence, when we're done, this is supposed to be a residential parcel, not something that could be a little hobby farm one day, because that just leads to conflict too.
Well, and if this were approved, it will come back to us for rezoning, which will involve the size of that structure. Councilor Rankin.
Just further with that, it's being reduced from 5 acres to 3 acres, and still 3 acres is quite substantial for a residential property.
Agreed. Okay, so I think generally we have a consensus not to support it. How do we go about
supporting it?
Curtis, do you have any suggested wording? This must happen other times.
Yeah. Yes. So there's maybe two. Yeah. Through Mayor Lennox to the clerk. So you could say indicate that we don't. It will not either a few options. You don't support it in at all. You don't support it as proposed, or you a third option, we could you support it at a specific size as well, and then However, we would suggest if it is approved, we would request these conditions be applied. So there'd probably be three initial comments, and then the second part to that would be, yeah, as if approved, the following conditions be applied.
So right now, the first part of the resolution reads that we received the report and further, and that council's support consent application as presented. So we would amend that to, and that council does not support consent application as presented. Does not. And that council, so this is where your options come in. You don't at all. Either support it with reduced size.
I would suggest that we could say support it with a lot size of 2 acres or less and excluding the existing accessory structure. Councillor?
Through you, Mayor Lennis, I just had a thought. If the property is for sale, and what part of it are they selling? Just the part that they're hoping to sever off? Are they selling the whole thing? And if they're going to sell it, why not let them sell the whole thing, and then the new owner can maybe just farm it as it is.
Councillor Hearn?
Well, I'm not going to get into exactly what they're doing, but what is for sale is retained farm parcel with the lot size that we're discussing here. So, and including, but I would like to verify, I still would like to have a condition in there that we verify that this is actually a farm consolidation as per our official plan.
Try again. So we received the report, and that council does not support consent application as presented, and further that council does support a lot size of 2 acres or less, and then you had mentioned about the building.
Yeah.
With
trying to think of how to incorporate the part that Councillor Hearn is talking about in terms of.
Curtis, is that something that we could actually like?
So yes, so through Mayor Lennox. So I can think back in my time in the county, there have been a few cases where people have indicated to the committee that, you know, they didn't have that was their intent, and that was something for them, and then the committee had to consider how to deal with that. So I think in this case is the owner, if I understand as what Councillor Hearn does, is if it's the same as what you do, that the intent is the owner would keep the house and then sell the farm portion. So I think in this case, I think trying to think, how do we condition that? Because that's, I think that's is a challenge for this application or others, when to ensure a farm consolidation, there's not an easy way to do that. Because at the end of the day, we once it's created and then it's sold, we can't control who it's sold to. And I think that's why we generally ask for that additional information and, ask that the applicant confirm that they are intending, that it is intended to be a farm consolidation. So I think it is a difficult condition. However desirable, it is a difficult condition. Now, maybe we could add it as a comment that council or the township, you know, would like confirmation from the applicant that it is a farm consolidation.
Would we put that back to the Land Division Committee, and further that council requests the Land Division Committee confirm that
perfect
is a farm consolidation?
Yeah.
Yes. Well, we're good at that.
And then you had mentioned something, Marilyn, about
2 acres or less, excluding the existing accessory structure.
Including existing.
Yes, with a more regular shape.
And further, that should the Land Division Committee approve the application, the following conditions be imposed.
Yes.
Take a vote on that, or you want me to?
So we need to move and second on that. Are you okay with the amendment as we've
placed it? I'm all right with it, yep.
Okay. Anything further from anybody? All those in favor? That's carried. Thank you. We'll move on, excuse me, to 1E. This is site plan agreement. We have a recommendation that the Council of the Corporation of the Township of Wellington North receive report DEV 31-2024 regarding the final approval of the Lloyd G. and Miriam B. Martin site plan control agreement. I get a mover and a seconder for that, please. Councilor McCabe, Councilor Rankin, thank you. Questions or comments on that one? All those in favor? That's carried. Thank you. So move on to 2A. Welcome back.
It's getting pretty
comfy. This is in regard to the Canadian Sport and Recreation Infrastructure Fund. And there is a lengthy recommendation that I know you have in front of you. So I would ask for a mover and a seconder for that. Councilor Rankin and Councilor Hearn, thank you. And I would open it up for questions or comments. It's two recommendations? Oh, okay. Okay, let me deal with the first one then. That the Council of Corporation of the Township of Wellington North receive report CNED 2024-44, Canadian Sport and Recreation Infrastructure Fund. And mover and seconder are okay with that? Any questions or comments on receiving that? All those in favor? That's carried. We'll move on to the second part of the recommendation, which is talking about the application in cooperation with the Arthur Curling Club. Can I get a mover and a seconder for that part of it? Councilor Burke, Councilor McCabe, thank you. Any questions or comments on that? Councilor McCabe?
Thank you. Through you, Mayor Lennox. I'm obviously in support of this and in support of any application where we can fund for the Arthur Curling Club or the pool. My question is probably for Mandy, I think, through you, obviously, Mayor Lennox. If the curling club or the pool are not successful in the funding application, where does that leave them? And will they still go through, or what's the thinking behind this?
Thank you, Councillor McCabe, through you, Mayor Lennox. So as far as I'm aware, with the curling club, they will continue to look for different funding options for the floor renovation project. Similarly, staff at the township are going to continue looking for funding applications for the pool. We are hopeful that it will be a successful application for Stream 2 for the new pool. For the second part of your question, I think I would turn it over to Chris, as he's probably got a better take on the curling club.
Go ahead, Chris.
Thank you, Mayor Lennox and Council. Just to echo Mandy, we would.
Chris, we can't hear you very well.
Okay, sorry, we're going to turn that up. I'll speak a little louder. I think what the Curling Club is planning on doing is we've looked at different options for our floor over the last number of years. And this particular stream for funding is one we wanted to see. Like, we'll go through the application process. If it does not succeed, then we will have to look at other avenues. The floor as it stands today is still operational, but we don't want to be in a position where it fails mid-season, or, you know, a year or two from now when we haven't done the proper planning. So we're just starting with this initial application.
Thanks. Yeah, I think I got most of that. Thanks, Chris. And thank you, Mayor Lennox.
Okay.
Thank you.
Any other questions, Councilor Burke?
So I'm just looking for some clarification, because I'm sorry, but I really couldn't hear Chris. So the Arthur Curling Club, again, thank you, Mandy, for putting this report together. I was a little bit surprised to hear about the Arthur Curling Club because we haven't heard anything about partnering with an application. Although I am always happy to do so. Having said that, the Arthur Curling Club has not completed applications for any other revenue streams. This is the first opportunity for a grant application. Is that correct? Okay. I'd be amiss if I didn't say, even though in the report it says it's two separate streams.
Okay, I think I've got this switched over now. I'm hoping you
Oh,
can hear
that's
me
much better.
better.
That's much better. Thank you.
This is the first opportunity that we've looked at. We've created our own internal fund where we've been raising money and kind of creating a bit of a slush fund to put towards this project. However, outside funding is going to be necessary to do this, just based on how the costs continue to increase quicker than what our fundraising seems to be able to do. If we use an example of the what you did at the arena in Arthur, $1 million to redo the floor, the curling club would be a little bit less than that, but we have to use that as our kind of our worst case scenario when we're trying to put a plan together.
Thank you.
This particular fund being 50% and a fairly large amount of funds that are available, it's kind of the first step, I guess. If we get that, then we know we can carry on with our other fundraising. And in the past, we've had to take out a loan to do some of the work that we've done at the curling club in the past. Always paid back early. And if we have to do that again, we will. We're a very healthy club. Like, we've done a lot of upgrades to the building and the club over the last 15 to 18 years. We want to keep doing that. We haven't actually been at council to request funds because we've been very self-sufficient.
Thank you.
Yeah, go ahead, Councillor Burke.
So, thank you for that. So, if it's unsuccessful, you'll look at other revenue streams. I guess my real concern is, even though further down in Mandy's report, it does outline that these are two separate streams, is there only one intake for stream one?
Go ahead, Mandy.
Thank you, Mayor Lennox. Yes, so there is only one intake for Stream One, and that deadline is October 29th. In speaking with our regional development advisor, she let us know that I apologize with my throat. She let us know that Stream One, they're not anticipating and then another one will open, and that it should not affect one application should not affect the other, but that ultimately does come to the minister's discretion. So they are anticipating that once Stream One closes, they will review all of those applications for Stream One, which is the a rehabilitation stream. After that time, they will start reviewing the Stream Two applications. So they are anticipating notifying individuals if they're successful in the early winter months.
Thank you. Thank you through you, Mayor Lennox. So I guess I'd be amiss if I didn't say that I was a little bit concerned about putting in two applications just based on the conversations that I've had with my colleagues and staff that were at AMO. As we know that we've been talking about the pool for a long time. And not that I don't want to see the Arthur Curling Club flourish. But if it was an application that could potentially be deferred to a later time and partnership with them through other revenue streams, I would be supportive of that, just based on the fact that we know the minister has our project in front of them already. And like I said, the pool we've been talking about for a long time, and it is a substantial fundraising effort for the volunteers that sit on the aquatics committee. And I'll just leave it at that.
So, Just Mandy, if you can confirm, this program is a federal program and the province may or may not add on to it. Is that the way this works?
So this one is through the province, the Canadian Sport Recreation Infrastructure Fund, but it's up to the minister's discretion. It is a 50-50 funding opportunity.
Okay.
So stream one is 50-50 and as is stream two.
Okay, so stream run is only eligible for rehabilitation projects.
Correct.
New projects like the pool would fall into the stream two category.
That's correct. Stream one is also funding for $150,000 to $1 million, and funding for stream two is up to $10 million. And the only caveat to stream two is that projects must be completed and no expenses incurred after March 31st, 2027. So staff are preparing an application for stream two for submission by the end of this year.
And that's the one that we spoke to the minister at AMO about.
Yes.
Any other questions or comments? Okay. All those in favor of the recommendation? Opposed? That's carried. Thank you. Move on to 4A. This is in regard to the municipal feedback policy. Excuse me. The recommendation that the Council of the Corporation of the Township of Wellington North receive report CAO 2024-14 municipal feedback policy, and that Council adopts the municipal feedback policy. Can I get a mover and a seconder for that, please? Councillor Rankin and Councillor Hearn, thank you. Questions or comments? Councillor McCabe?
Excuse me, through you, Mayor Lennox. This is probably for you, Brooke, I would imagine. With this feedback, the municipal feedback policy, how does this align with our strategic plan? And will it be tied to our year review that we always do? And then I've got a quick follow-up after, if you don't mind.
Through you, Mayor Lennox. So yes, this policy is directly in line with the strategic plan in terms of the third goal that was approved by council. So that really is about ensuring that the public have an opportunity to provide feedback and engage in providing comments that will help shape decision-making. So it will do this in a few ways. One is that it allows us to get more structured feedback on a whole variety of topics. And start to keep track of that and make sure we're providing proper responses back and tracking that, using that data then to help inform our policy, any recommendations that we come to council with, and just our operations in general. And then in terms of our year in review, I think we like to highlight the ways that the work that the township is doing connects to that strategic plan. And so we can talk about this feedback policy, which is really an update to kind of a similar-ish policy that was adopted, I think, in 2017. So this is a good update and provides, again, that structure that we can use. And then if there's specific decisions that are made or recommendations that come forward to council that are able to kind of tap into that feedback that we've received, we can also edit that in our
response. Great. Thank you. And kind of answered my next question, which was how often would be updated. So it's like it's a ongoing project. That's thanks for the work that's done on that and having transparency, I guess, for our residents and an avenue for them to comment and give us feedback or give staff feedback, I think is vital. So thank you.
Any other questions or comments? I just have a couple of quick ones. So I assume that, as we're receiving feedback, this will provide us a tracking mechanism for it. And then the other part of the question I have is sometimes council members receive feedback. Is there a mechanism or is there a recommendation in terms of the best way for us to feed the feedback? Sorry about that. To share that feedback and make sure it's included in this process.
Through you, Mayor Lennox. Yeah, the intent would be to kind of streamline some of that feedback process. And so right now we do have several different ways people can provide feedback. and so if council is receiving questions or getting comments, this will be something that you can refer the members of the public to and they can submit it, or you can forward it to us and we can put it through the process. It doesn't have to be sort of duplicated in terms of efforts, but it allows us to, again, track that feedback, see if there's any trends, and then make sure that the appropriate service areas are getting a chance to look at that and respond to it if appropriate, or hold on to it until it becomes sort of part of any process that we look at going forward. So, and I should mention, in terms of just the efforts, Tasha Raffos and Karen worked on this, and it was circulated amongst all our senior management team as well. So they've all had a chance to look at this and understand the implications and how we'll implement it going forward.
Okay, thank you. Any other questions or comments? Councilor Rankin.
Through you, Mayor Lennox, just one. If a councilor should happen to receive an application from this, we're not to know whether it's already been duplicated and sent on to the township as well. So we're still submitting them and let the staff know whether and sort it out whether it's a duplicate or not.
Yes, you can always forward it to any member of staff and we'll have sort of a streamlined process that we can make sure that if it hasn't been already captured, we can capture it and then move it through the process.
Any other questions or comments? All those in favor? Thank you. I think that brings us to the end of the items for consideration. Any notice of motion? Evening. Seeing none. Excuse me, we'll move on to community group meeting program report. Anybody have anything they'd like to inform? Councilor McCabe, go ahead.
Thank you. And through you, we had Saugeen Valley Conservation Authority had their monthly meeting, and staff are still not in the building yet. I know the last meeting there was a lightning strike, so the people have not staff haven't been allowed back in just yet. So hopefully that'll be soon. Had their monthly Roma meeting as well, and we're nailing down speakers and session subjects and keynote speakers as well. So that should be coming out fairly shortly. So,
Councilor Rankin, go ahead.
Thank you. Regarding the cultural roundtable, we had a meeting last Thursday, and the Metz Pumpkin Fest had the best draw of attendance that they've had. Their winning pumpkin was over 600 pounds, the biggest they've had. They've even incorporated pumpkin bowling this year, so it was quite a success. The artisan showcase, I think, was successful considering it was put together at the last minute, and we went on a Thanksgiving weekend. Next year, we already have more artisans that are willing to come, and it will be on a different date, so we're expecting a better turnout there as well. And also, as an extension of the farmers market, there are market boxes available for the winter season, and they're $90. So I think if you're interested in one, because the value would be more than that, is to contact Economic Development Officer Robin Mulder.
Anybody have anything else you'd like to report on? Councilor Hearn?
I just sent everyone information about the Arthur BIA annual general meeting, which will be on the 20th. Now that's going to be a hybrid meeting. So if you want to come, you can either attend in person or attend virtually.
Thank you. Anybody else? Okay, well,
sorry. Go ahead. I guess I should mention the Lions are having an event at the Cenotaph Friday morning at 9. And to honor Dr. Samuels, and this is part of their 85th anniversary celebrations for the month of November. So anyone on council or staff can make it. It will be at 9 a.m. in Arthur Center.
Thank you, Councilor McCabe, for agreeing to step in for that on my behalf. With that, we'll move on to bylaws. Recommendation here that bylaw number 89-2024 be read as passed. Can I get a mover and a seconder for that, please? Councilor McCabe, Councilor Rankin, thank you. Any questions or comments? All those in favor? Great. So move on to our cultural moment.
The Wellington North Cultural Roundtable presents A Cultural Moment, Flax Production in Arthur. At the corner of Wellington Road 109 and Wellington Road 11, as you turn south to go to Drayton, you will cross a bridge that bears the sign Flax Bridge. It is a reminder to us of the thriving flax industry in Arthur from 1870 to 1920. Flax was an early cash crop in what was then Upper Canada. It was usually not fine enough to use as clothing, but was very useful for rope, upholstery, and feed bags. An important product as well was the linseed oil that could be pressed out and fed to cattle. The arrival of the railroad in 1871 likely helped to get the crop to the nearest flax mill, about 12 miles away in Sturton. Flax is a labor-intensive crop. The entire plant must be pulled from the ground to preserve the length of the fibers, bundled, stooked, and dried in the field. At the mill, seed pods were removed and stalks taken outside to dry further, spread out on length, and flipped after a few weeks for further drying. Machines would separate the fibers into longer lengths, which were often sent abroad for further refining. Indigenous peoples were often involved in flax processing, which paid well, sometimes up to $2.25 per hour. The cost of growing and processing flax was often close to the market price to be earned, so it was referred to as the gambler's crop. The two world wars were important factors for the flax industry in Arthur, as there was a great demand for flax linen for airplane wings. Once the cost of production exceeded market price, flax production ceased in Arthur and the two mills there closed. In Western Canada, flax continued to be a crop that would help break new ground and in fact continues production there. A detailed article on flax production in Arthur is printed in Volume 37 of the Wellington County History, the 2024 edition of the annual publication of the Wellington County Historical Society.
On to our permanent bylaw, recommendation of bylaw number 90-2024, the bylaw of permanent proceedings of the Council of Corporation of the Township of Wellington North. As regularly held on the first month of the form of the Board of Red and House. Second, that's the permanent, that's the written, thank you. All those in favor? Carried. And we adjourn to draw your net meetings. And we're going to go on to the resource speed networking event, you know, tomorrow, 9 to 11:30 at the Arthur Community Center. Of course, Fox at our pleasure committee as we meet tomorrow at 7 p.m. It's lower each of all of the topics worked on West. Arthur Chamber of Commerce, EGM, Wednesday at 6 to 9 p.m. So I mean, culture crossovers, October 26th. And our next regular council meeting is Monday, November. That will be adjourned as a recommendation of the regular council meeting on October 23rd, 2024. Be adjourned at 8:09 p.m. April 7th, Nelson Burton, Council Dave, thank you. All those in favor? Carried. For adjourned. Thank you, everyone.